is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your podcast co-host. We are following a slightly different format in our podcast today. If you're a regular listener, you know that we do an occasional interview that we call our Thriving in Dentistry series. And today is going to be one of those interviews with my friend and client, Dr. Kevin Kellerman. Hey, Kevin, how are you?
Hey, Gary. Thanks for having me.
Oh, it's my pleasure. I'm so glad that you're here. Kevin is a practicing dentist in Glen Carbon, Illinois, a little bit east of St. Louis. You're what, about 20, 30 minutes east of St. Louis?
That's exactly right, Gary.
Yeah. In kind of downstate Illinois. Once we get outside of town, I think you've got lots of cornfields around you.
There's plenty of them around, and I have a lot of farmers as patients, and it's a great place to be.
Yeah. Well, hey, I wanted to invite Kevin on this podcast interview because he's doing some really cool things in his practice. And the reason why we do this Thriving in Dentistry series is multiple reasons. One is so you can hear from some of your colleagues. You can kind of hear their story and how they have kind of followed a path in dentistry. I also think these are inspirational, can maybe provide you some inspiration of things that they've done that might be applicable to you, and maybe help you save some mistakes. If any of our Thriving in Dentistry series docs have stepped in the mud, maybe they can save you from stepping in the mud. I know a lot about Kevin and his practice, and I knew he'd be a great addition to the show. Kevin, I know your story, of course, but our listeners don't. Would you be kind enough to share a little bit about your story in terms of becoming a dentist and life after dental school?
Yeah, Gary, absolutely. I'd be happy to. I graduated from dental school in 2002. I went to Southern Illinois University School of Dental Medicine. And at the time, I wasn't quite ready for practice ownership. I knew I had some more things to learn. And, you know, there was this little group that was just getting started at the time. A few of my friends that had graduated a year or two before me, they were working there. And quite frankly, they were having a good experience. So I started to work with Heartland Dental Group in 2002.
That was fairly early in the Heartland journey. Of course, I know Rick Workman pretty well. Rick's a good friend. And Heartland, of course, they started before then.
Right.
You were on the earlier stage of Heartland's development.
Gary, I'm pretty confident I was one of the first 50.
Yeah.
Of course, now they're over 1,000, right?
But actually, as of today, I believe it's 1,497.
Wow.
1,497 locations.
Yeah, wow.
Now that could change, so don't quote me on that. And when you listen to that, that might have changed again. But I was going to say, I think you were in the first 30 or 40 at that time. And maybe it was first 50. But you were on the early stage of development. And, you know, that could be a very good opportunity coming right out of dental school. Very good, because you get to work on some things. You get to work on your hand speed. You know, let's face it. Dental school isn't the best environment to learn hand speed. It's not set up for that.
Right. You know, Gary, my experience with Heartland was really a positive experience. I learned a lot of clinical skills, a lot of leadership skills. They taught us communication techniques with our team members and our patients, and quite frankly, helped us learn how to even run a business.
Wow, very cool. And I, you know, I know you weren't necessarily on, you know, day-to-day interaction with Rick, but he was, I imagine he was a mentor for you as well.
Certainly. You know, like I said, they were still small. And so I had a lot of FaceTime with Rick. He did a lot of meetings with us. And he was really inspiring. He really knew how to lead the group. And I looking back, I think that was a valuable time period in my career.
Time well spent.
It was.
Take it from there. So it's been a journey. Where did you go from there?
Yeah, so I was with Heartland for about 4 years, but one of the reasons I got into dentistry is because I had that entrepreneurial itch that I needed to scratch, and I told Rick and Pat and the guys, I was like, listen, I've had a great time here, but it's just always been my desire to start a dental practice. So taking what I had learned from Heartland, I found a location. I was thinking I would purchase a practice, but in the end, I did a scratch start.
So talk about that a little bit, Kevin. I'm often asked that question from young doctors. Hey, should I buy a practice or should I start a practice? And, you know, my answer is it depends, you know, because sure. Both paths can be useful paths. Talk a little bit about your decision to start one rather than buying one.
Well, it wasn't a decision I took lightly. I think what I did first is I picked where I wanted to live. I actually tried to find doctors who were willing to take on an associate or who were looking to transition. I didn't find any takers, but I was young and I had all this energy and I had learned a lot from Rick at Heartland. And I was like thinking, well, I feel like I can do this. And I kind of copied their business model, so to speak. And here we are, you know, 16 years later, and it's been quite a nice adventure.
Yeah, you started that practice in 2006, if I remember right.
That's exactly right.
Yeah. Flashback 16 years ago. What were the early days like? Were you sitting around or were you fortunate to have some nice patient flow from the beginning?
Well, this is a really interesting story, but this is really one of the reasons you and I have worked together now for a number of years, because my practice has really transitioned over time. But again, I followed the Heartland model and they knew how to start a practice. And one of the ways they got patients right away was with the insurances they took. They took a lot of insurances, including Medicaid and all the PPOs. So that's what I did. And it's great in the sense of patient flow, but I knew that wasn't my dream to work that way forever. So we've transitioned over time, but that's how I got my start.
Yeah. And that's not necessarily, I wouldn't consider that a negative, because if you're starting from scratch, you need some patient flow. Mm-hmm. And certainly being a member dentist on PPO plans can be a good way to get that initial patient flow. But mm-hmm. I also know from the history that you didn't want that to be a permanent fixture in your practice. It was more of a transitional plan.
Absolutely. You know, it being a new business, we needed to, you know, run it like a business and then smartly transition it over time.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I'll take the discussion a little bit different direction. You've taken a lot of postgraduate CE in your career. You're a very, very, very skilled dentist. Talk a little bit about the type of dentistry that you like to do most. What are some clinical areas that really kind of tickle you?
Oh, gosh, Gary. I would like to say that I'm a general dentist at heart. I love being a comprehensive care dentist. I really love oral surgery, implants, and, wisdom teeth. I do a lot of those types of procedures, But I'm a general dentist at heart, and I really just enjoy the spectrum of my day to day.
Yeah, I kind of think of your practice as being similar to ours, mine, with Paul and Tim, where we're very much a general dental foundation, a general family practice. I think of that as our bread and butter. Would that be an accurate description of your practice?
Completely. We definitely we provide smile designs for people. We do a lot of cosmetic work. We do Invisalign, oral sedation, sleep apnea. We help people with sleep apnea appliances. So we definitely provide the higher value procedures, but we're as part of our day to day.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I happen to think that's really a solid business model where general dentistry is our core, but then we're available to do high value services when it's needed or wanted.
I love it. And people love just being able to take care of most things under one roof. You know, like I've had many people talk me into taking extractions out that I initially thought, I'm not sure, but I do have a lot of confidence and they always work out okay. But I'm just glad that we can do most things where we are and not ask people to go somewhere else.
Yeah. Talk about some of your clinical mentors in your journey. Talk about who's kind of shaped you in terms of postgraduate CE.
Sure. Yeah. Well, you know, in the early days, I was a student of Dr. John Coyce. I took his curriculum. He laid the foundation for me. I know you're good friends with Dr. Hornbrook.
David is a longtime friend. And by the way, what a great mentor to have in Dr. Coyce. John's amazing. You were fortunate to find him earlier in your career.
Yes, indeed. Pack Live, Gary. Remember Pack Live?
Yeah. Yeah,
goodness. Maybe you were involved with that in some capacity. I don't recall, but
yeah,
a great cosmetic course.
I was there at the very foundation with Dr. Hornbrook at Pack Life. That's kind of where you got, a lot of your start in aesthetic dentistry was from David.
No doubt about it. I did the Pack Life course and that gave me the confidence of how to do veneers and cosmetic crowns.
Yeah. 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 I love sharing mentors with our listening audience because they can be real accelerators in your practice for sure. And you're a good example of that.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. I can't imagine not having that training in my career at any point in my career. It just enriches your day to day at such a high level that I would really encourage everyone to explore those opportunities.
Yeah. Now, I think of your practice as embracing technology as well. Talk a little bit about the technology that is important to you to have in your practice.
Sure, Gary. Yeah, when I think about technology, is really something that gives me a lot of joy and enthusiasm every day. And I know currently,
keeps you interested, right?
Oh, it's so fun, and patients really do appreciate it. Even electric handpieces. You know, we bought electric handpieces a couple of years ago, and right from the beginning, patients were like, "That feels a little bit better. That's not quite as loud as I remember." And I was like, yeah, you're right. So electric handpieces we love. We love our CEREC technology, our same-day crowns. That's really been one of the biggest crowd pleasers from the patient perspective recently in my practice.
You know, it's interesting to bring up electric handpieces because I think that's a technology that is often missed or overlooked. Mm-hmm. You know, it's frankly, it's one of your most important pieces of technology or piece of equipment as a dentist. But I'm surprised that really quality electric handpieces aren't used more in dentistry. Talk about that.
Well, I was skeptical at first. I really was. I just couldn't imagine why it would be better. But everyone always said, "Hey, Kevin, once you try it, you won't regret it. You know, you'll be a believer." And I kind of took them at their word and it makes the experience more pleasant for the clinician and the patient they're quieter, they're smoother, they cut more efficiently. So from a clinician point of view, you're more efficient.
So you're not giving those up. No way.
There's no way I will. No, you're never.
Just like your colleagues told you, once you use it, you're not going back.
That's right. There's no doubt about it.
You know, just a comment, Kevin, I know you know this, but one of the occupational hazards for dentists is hearing loss. And it's very common. So the point about quieter, I think is something that we need to emphasize even more. Sadly, many dentists that are mid-career and later often have irreparable hearing damage. So very important.
Yeah. Well, Gary, that was one of my primary motivators when I considered the investment in them was that. I mean, that's just been something I've always been aware of.
Yeah. And I don't mind naming names. Is there a brand of electric handpiece that you really like?
So I use the NSKs.
Excellent.
And I did a lot of research and there are certainly other high quality brands out there, but that's what I chose and I have no regrets.
Excellent. Well, it's nice to have firsthand recommendation from, what's working for you.
Thank you.
For sure. Have you made any technology blunders? I sometimes learn as much from my mistakes. I think I learn more from my mistakes. It's like what not to do next time. But if you can look in the rearview mirror, is there any technology that you were excited about and had high expectations and turned out to be not so much?
Well, sadly, maybe. But, you know, with that being said, one example I will use, and I think, you know, but there's different kinds of lasers out there. And I love lasers. There are certain indications where I'm so glad I have my laser. But one time I'm like, they're telling me I can replace my handpiece with this laser. That sounds cool. And so I tried that. Now, it didn't work so well for me. I know it's worked well for others.
Yeah.
But I found that maybe the tried and true handpiece was better for some situations and for me worked better in my hands.
Yeah, it's kind of funny because I think of lasers in some applications as almost being must-have.
Right, right.
You know, well, even a simple diode laser for gingival recontouring.
Yes.
I mean, you know that from PAC Live that, you know, you're going to do this gorgeous, you know, lab fabricated porcelain veneer case. But if we've got, you know, gum symmetry issues, then David used to always teach that as think of the gums as the frame that goes around the picture. Mm-hmm. And if you have your diode laser, you can do painless gingival recontouring and really finish the case in a way that wouldn't quite be there if we didn't have that. So
it
maybe has more to do with the application of the laser. Because I think of lasers in that application as being almost must have.
Yeah. Well, hey, I love oral surgery. So if I ever need to uncover an implant, I don't know what I would do without my laser. I love lasers in certain applications.
Well, and think about frenectomy. Are you going to do a frenectomy with a scalpel, electrosurge, or laser? Let me think about it.
Another great example. Yeah. Yep. You're right.
That would be a laser. We had them in clinic at PAC Live. And we had, you know, and at that time they were newer, you know, in the application, but we had them there and, you know, Dennis would, you know, grab the diode laser to do primarily gingival recontouring. But, there was, an assistant that was part of the program who had her young daughter there. And frankly, her daughter needed a frenectomy. So, David said, would you mind if I just do that frenectomy for her now with a laser? And so just put her in the chair and did the frenectomy. And anyway, I remember a couple hours later, a dentist coming, hey, can I take a look at that? And he, you know, he's a real friendly dentist. Said, can I take a look at that and see how your tissue looks? And she said, sure. And she literally takes her lip and almost pulls it over her head.
Oh my gosh.
I'm exaggerating a little bit, but not quite, not too much. And he said, well, but just answered the next question about how comfortable you are right now. Because she was perfectly comfortable. I'd say that's a practice builder, wouldn't you?
Oh, anytime speaking of frenectomies, anytime someone says, this is what I need to do or what I've been told, I explain the laser and I explain the scalpel. And I was like, but we use the laser and they're just so relieved. They love the idea.
And certainly lasers are not new in dentistry, but among the public, it still is kind of leading edge.
It is.
Right.
Yeah. And people will choose us because of laser too. I will say that for like frenectomies and things. So,
yeah. You know, so. Yeah. Well, I would concur with your experience about the laser as a handpiece replacement. Although, again, for those of our listeners that have made that transition and wouldn't go back, great.
Mm-hmm. But yeah.
I would kind of concur with your experience there for sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Now, as you continue to develop your practice, talk about some milestones along the way to today. Very different practice than the one you started in 2006.
We do, Gary. Yeah. And I'll say thank you to you for being a part of that because, I always knew where I wanted to go, but just like anything, sometimes you're not like, I see it, but how do I get there? So, but you know, you have showed us how to one transition and help us reduce our dependence on insurance. And we've successfully gone in that direction.
We're not quite at the finish line, but we're well on the way.
We are on the way. That's right. And yeah.
And I, by the way, you guys have been a model practice in terms of doing all the prep necessary so that when we go out of network, you keep as many in-network patients as possible. And you guys have been just fantastic from a coach's standpoint of doing all the prep work to make sure we keep as many existing in-network patients as possible. And really, I know the answer to this, but I bet you're pretty happy with the percentage of patients that you've retained.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Well, the way you've taught us on how to communicate, it makes sense to us. And since we have been using it for a while now, we've seen the results from it. So we're like, hey, you know, when we communicate in Gary's recommendation, the patients are receptive and it makes sense to them. And it's a good way to just communicate with people and make it comfortable for everyone.
And you know, Glen Carbon, Illinois is, mm-hmm. it's a wonderful community. But I wouldn't think of it as an affluent community. Is that accurate?
Definitely accurate. Yeah. No, it's not Beverly Hills. It's not
even Gold Coast of Lake Michigan in Chicago. We're
Southern Illinois. Okay. Yeah. So
how would you characterize, I know you have a mix of patients, of course, like we do. How would you characterize your patient base? Socioeconomic.
Okay. It is a good mix. I mean, we definitely have a lot of professionals. We are near, you know, St. Louis, which is, yeah. you know, a nice, you know, city.
You're really, even though it's across state lines, you're a bedroom community of St. Louis.
That's right. We're a bedroom community of St. Louis or Southern Illinois across the Mississippi River from St. Louis. But, you know, we have a nice little mix of blue collar and white collar workers. We have school teachers. We have college professors. Yeah. A nice mix.
I think of your practice, just if I'm trying to find the apex of the bell-shaped curve of your patient base, I think of it as very much a middle-class patient base.
Definitely.
Would that be accurate? Is that accurate in your...
Oh, definitely. Your yes.
Yeah. And yes. Again, certainly you have some, you have white collar professionals as well. And, you know, you have those that live paycheck to paycheck, you know, in your practice.
Sure.
But
absolutely.
I think of kind of the apex of your practice as being a blue collar practice.
Yes. Yeah. You nailed it, Gary. That's exactly right.
Yeah. And I know one of your concerns, if you're okay with me sharing it, I know one of your concerns in going out of network was, hey, I really like my patients. I want to keep them. And I was encouraging to you and saying, well, if we do it right, we're going to keep the vast majority of these patients. You'll lose some. Do you remember me telling you, Kevin, that you are going to lose some? I'm not going to sugarcoat it. You're going to lose some patients.
Yes. It came with fair warning. They're guaranteed.
Yeah. But I said, you know, my corollary to that is I think you're going to be really pleasantly surprised when you discover how many of them you're actually going to keep. And that's been true.
Yes. It's definitely true. It's reassuring. It feels good. It feels good that people choose us even though they don't have to.
Yeah. Yeah. And there's other choices. I mean, it's not like there aren't other in-network dentists that are nearby. I mean, they've got choices.
Many choices in our town. That's yeah. right.
One of the reasons I credit your success with that, Kevin, is the relationship-driven aspect of your practice. I see your practice as very much relationship driven, where you know your patients, you know their names, their spouse's name, their kids' names, their dog's name, their hobbies, their interests, important dates in their life, and your team is an extension of you in that regard. Mm-hmm. How have you created that culture in your practice so that your team members are on the same page as you?
Gary, that's an awesome question. And it's just been very important to me to have a relationship-driven practice. And I've decided the best way for me to create that is just to make sure the team understands my vision. And so through proper, you know, through regular communication, we have weekly team meetings, monthly team meeting, you know, we do a lot of communicating and a lot of meetings to make sure we're all on the same page. And I just think through the years, you know, they're a great team and they've absorbed it and they feel the same way I do. And it's our daily mission is just to make sure people have a good experience. And we want them to leave, you know, feeling better than when they came in. And that's really our goal. It's sincerely our goal.
Yeah. I love the way you answered that question, that it begins with a really clear, strong vision. Yours is clear. It's strong. And the other thing I would say to add to what you've said, you model it. In other words, you don't ask your team members to do anything you wouldn't do yourself. So it isn't like, hey, this relationship thing is, you know, I'm the dentist. I'll be over here with the handpiece. You guys go do the relationship stuff. No, it doesn't work that way. You model it and you provide the lead so that the team members can mimic you in terms of what you do and your values. And that, I don't know if you realize that because you're so close to it, but I see that very much part of the success quotient for you for sure.
Yeah. And I think the team, you know, we've had people self-select out through the years. But I think, you know, it takes a special person to want to provide that type of service to our patients.
Yeah. Yeah. And you've got an amazing team. I've had the privilege of meeting your team, and they literally, you've got in every department, you've got fantastic team members. And that isn't easy to do these days, for sure.
No, it's not. I mean, it's always a work in progress. And I just go back to the, you know, stay in contact with your team, you know, the person, well, personal and professional and personal relationships with your team members too. I mean, you know, we like to do things outside of the office on a regular basis, just for that bonding and team building.
Yeah. Those team building activities, you know, another example of modeling is if we want our team members to model relationship driven with your patients, then we can model relationship driven with them. And what I mean by that is, do we know our team members' spouses' names? Do we know their kids' names? Do we know their dog's name? Do we know their hobbies? Do we know their interests? Do we know their values? Do we know their favorite food? And hey, you've got a large team. I have a large team. And yet I think that's another way we can model it in a subtle way. We can model what we expect them to exhibit to our patients by showing that to them. And also, I think it's the ultimate form of respect to really get to know our team members.
Yeah, absolutely. It's, you know, one of your six goals that you have for every dentist is to work with a team that you enjoy being with. And and I agree. That's certainly a secret to the success of the business.
Yeah, it's my fourth goal. It's to have a high performance team you truly love and enjoy working with. And I hand selected that, you know, that phrase. I did say love. I didn't say like. I didn't say tolerate. I didn't say put up with. I didn't say she has seen the last one. She's better than her.
Yeah.
And that's even more important today than ever, because dental team members are being recruited by other, you know, outside of dentistry. And we've got to make sure we're always providing the best game in town. I don't mean just in dentistry, but, you know, providing the best employment opportunity for them. And I think you're doing a stellar job of that for sure.
Oh, thank you, Gary. I appreciate that.
Now, I also know you. You wear a number of hats besides being a dentist, being a leader, being a visionary. But I think of you as an entrepreneur and investor as well.
Sure.
Talk a little bit about some of the decisions that you've made that actually tie in to your practice. Talk a little bit about what you've done in terms of investing, kind of always looking ahead to the future.
Sure. Yeah. Well, first of all, when I opened my business, I tried to locate a building that I could actually own. And I found one. I found a building that I could purchase. So I'd always heard that that would be an excellent long-term investment. And there was a 6,000 square foot building, and I bought about half of it at the time. Okay. And then the other half was bought by a psychiatrist. So he and I were business neighbors. And then about 2 years ago, he approached me and said, "Hey, Kevin, I'm thinking about relocating. Would you like to consider purchasing my side of the building?" And I said, well, we are growing. I do need more space. That probably makes sense. So I purchased his side of the building, so now I own the entire building.
About 6,000 square feet.
That's correct. And I now plan to expand into that space within the next year. So
very cool.
I think long-term that will work really well from an investment side as well.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, I always tell my clients that if it's possible for you to own your building, I'd like you to do that. Mm-hmm. That's not always possible.
Right.
Kevin, if you were a few hundred miles north in downtown Chicago, that might not be possible to own your building.
Sure. Right? Absolutely.
But certainly in Glen Carbon, you could do that. And, you know, and now, you know, you're going to end up owning that building at some point. As opposed to if you're going to lease that, you'd end up with lease receipts. You wouldn't end up with any equity. And
right.
It's likely over time that that building's going to appreciate. That's been the history of commercial estate.
Right.
It's likely that that's going to appreciate. And so, yeah, you've added a nice asset to your portfolio by owning that building. And in fact, by jumping at the opportunity to double it and own the space next door as well.
Yeah, absolutely. It just seemed to make sense to me, and I'm glad I did it.
Yeah, good for you. And that's a message I always try to share with my clients is if at all possible, let's try to get you in an ownership position in your building so that you can get the benefits of that asset as well. You know, Kevin, I know we have a little bit more work to do in your practice yet. You've recently had an opportunity to add a great associate to your practice. I'm excited about that. And I'm excited about completing the journey to continue to reduce insurance dependence. We're honing in on the finish line.
We've made a ton of progress, and yeah, there isn't, we're down to a few, less than, you know, when I first started, Gary, I think it was like a dozen.
Yeah.
And now we're under five. So, yeah.
And I always talk about it as being reducing insurance dependence, not necessarily going fee for service. Although I always say that if your goal is to be fee for service, I will be your biggest cheerleader. I'll be cheering you on. Right. However, success could be getting down to one or two.
Yeah.
Especially if you started out with a dozen, right?
Sure. Oh my gosh. Yeah.
You're making great progress. I know the entire team is motivated to continue the journey.
They are.
Because you've had great results in keeping a very high percentage of your existing in-network patients. Mm-hmm. And, you know, think about it. Kevin, let me just play with you here for a minute. So imagine, now I know your office manager.
Yes.
And she's fabulous, by the way, as you know. And
agreed.
She's also a really good guard at the gate. Meaning that if there's a salesperson coming to call on you, unless they have an appointment set up ahead of time, the chance of getting past her is virtually zero. Would that be a fair statement?
She does a fantastic job. Yes.
But imagine that maybe she was off that day and a salesman comes a calling and somehow sneaks past and ends up in your office.
Okay.
Okay. Now we did not talk about this ahead of time. Okay.
No.
So fair notice. I have not forewarned Kevin in this conversation. So imagine there's a salesperson sitting in your office and you've had a hectic day and, you know, you've been running all day and taking care of patients and you just want, you know, 2 minutes to catch your breath in your office and you step into your office and here's this salesman and says, Dr. Kellerman, it's your lucky day. Have I got a deal for you? Here's what I'm going to offer you today. I'm going to provide you with new patients in your practice. And all you have to do is pay me 45% of your production for as long as that patient's a patient in your practice. That's all you have to do. Sign here, doctor. I would politely suggest that individual would be kicked out of your office faster than he would possibly imagine.
No doubt about that.
And yet, what have I just described, Kevin?
Yeah, no, I know. You've described a PPO in network
plan.
Yeah.
You pay, and 45%, by the way, might be light today in terms of what I'm seeing with fee schedules. The other day we had looked at this for a client of ours on the East Coast, and the difference between his usual fees and his contracted fees were 52%. He was only getting 48% of his UCR fees.
Oh no. Yeah. The gap, it just gets wider year by year.
Yeah. But I mean,
I'd like to say it's
any dentist signing up for that deal. No.
I'd like to say the gap is widening because our fees are going up, but in reality, I think it's because the reimbursements are going down.
Yeah, that is so very true. Aetna just announced across the board a 15% fee reduction across the board in their PPO plan. And that was after giving their CEO a raise In 2019, the CEO's salary was only $19.7 million a year. Now, Kevin, you can hardly live on $19.7 million a year. I mean, right?
I know.
And anyway, they raised his salary. Are you ready for this? $67 million a year.
Oh, my goodness.
How do you think Aetna did during COVID, by the way?
Well, they were still collecting premiums, right?
And how, in March, March, April, and May, how were they doing on paying claims in 2020?
Yeah, I don't know if we collected a whole lot during those months. So
they made a massive profit. And he was given a raise from 19.7 million a year to $67 million a year. And now they come out with, and now we're going to cut your fees 15%. It's just, let me get on my soapbox for just a minute, Kevin. It's time that we stop the abuse. Dental insurance companies have done a really good job over the years of bamboozling dentists into making you think you need them. When in fact, who needs who? In the relationship, does the dentist need the insurance company or does the insurance company need the dentist?
That seems like an obvious answer to me, right?
I mean, if they don't have you, they have no policy to sell. They need you. And I love the direction we're taking with your practice, and you and your team have been great implementers. And of course, the end result has been patient retention and a stronger practice. The dentist isn't the only one that feels like they're the proverbial hamster on the treadmill when you have to pedal like that.
Right.
Team members feel that as well.
Well, and let me say, Gary, the rewards, it benefits the whole team. The rewards are, they're emotional, they're physical, they're financial. I mean, for the whole team. So yeah, there's no one on my team that has any regrets about the direction we're going.
Yeah. One of the things I loved in working with your practice was how much support I got from your office manager. In terms of just tell me what to do, Gary.
Yeah.
And I will do it. Let me know it and I'll follow through on it. But very, very, very supportive. And because she knew the bigger picture of where we were going with this and why it was not only in your best interests and her best interests and her team members' best interests, but ultimately in your patient's best interests. You can't invest in the technology that you'd like to invest in if you don't have a profitable practice. And so, there'll be new technology coming that we haven't even heard about yet.
Right.
And I'm pretty confident that you will be, interested if it makes sense in your practice in adding technology if it benefits your patient. And you can't do that unless you have a profitable practice. So you're a great example of a doctor that understands that ultimately if it benefits our patients, then it makes sense. And I think reducing insurance dependence is a pathway to be able to do that. In much more of a win-win way, a win for, really it's win-win-win. It's a win for you, it's a win for your team, and it's a win for your patients.
Absolutely, yeah.
And if we have to kick the PPO plan to the curb, that's okay by me.
Me too, Gary.
As we kind of come to the finish line here today, Kevin, any final thoughts? Let me ask you more specifically.
Okay.
We have dentists at every stage of their career that listen to the Thriving Dentist Show. We actually have listeners in 188 countries, kind of crazy. But there's a group of our listeners that are younger dentists kind of plotting and planning their career path. What would you say to a young dentist early in his or her career about the future of dentistry?
Oh, gosh. I think it's exciting. I say that because you really can create what you want to create, Gary, you help people really well with creating like a less insurance or no insurance independent practice. I think, being an entrepreneur, working with technology, sharing a vision, I recommend, continue education courses for your foundation, for your clinical skills, and just being a constant student of not only clinical dentistry, but leadership.
Yeah. And I also think, practice ownership gives you an opportunity to create a practice that provides a work-life balance. I didn't prep you ahead of time. How do you feel about your work-life balance at this stage of your career? How do you feel? It may not be perfect, but how do you feel about your work-life balance?
I'm in a good situation right now. You know, we've grown and you've helped me, you know, learn that work-life balance aspect. You've helped me.
It's not a myth, right?
No, it's not a myth at all. I mean, I work Monday through Wednesday most weeks. Every now and then I have a Friday, and that's a half day. So I'm primarily Monday through Wednesday because I have an associate, like you said. You helped me go through that process of finding someone, training them, implementing them to the culture of the practice. And I live a good life, Gary. I'm very thankful.
I'll be very cryptic on this. I really feel like the 3-day doctor work week is a great pathway to achieve work-life balance. It really is. Dentistry's hard. I mean, can we agree on that?
For sure.
It's hard. It's hard physically and emotionally.
Yes.
And I really think that the 3-day week gives you a chance to recharge your batteries, gives you a chance to spend more time with your family, gives you a chance to take a massive amount of CE and not take it at the expense of your family. And it truly gives you the opportunity to, you know, be TGIM. You know, Paul works the same schedule, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And I think about, you know, we know the traditional acronym TGIF. You know, thank goodness it's Friday. But I really think for a thriving dentist, it can be TGIM. Thank goodness it's Monday. I get to come to work on Monday.
Yeah.
And I think you've got that. And I mean, I don't, you know, not that you don't experience speed bumps and challenges sometimes, but I really think you have made massive progress towards achieving a work-life balance that's really effective.
Yeah. And I thank you for that, Gary. I sincerely do, because it's just hard to do everything on our own. You know, the outside view from 20,000 feet above is definitely a big help.
Yeah. Well, Kevin, thank you. Thanks for joining me on this Thriving Dentist Show. I appreciate you sharing your story with our listeners. Your story is inspiring. And I hope that our listeners will find some pearls in here that they can apply in their practice and their career path. So thanks for joining us today. I'm glad we had a chance to do this interview.
Hey, I enjoyed being here and thanks for having me on.
Hey, I also want to take a minute and thank our listeners. We love what we do at the Thriving Dentist Show, but I try never to lose track of the fact that we couldn't do it without you. So let me take a minute and thank you for the privilege of your time and tell you I will look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. When you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. And when you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.